I've lost my best friend. I had to go through all the major stages in my life on my own. Like when I make my communion, Mary should have been there. When I got married, Mary should have been there by my side, being the bridesmaid. Even when I had my kids, Mary should be there. But I've had to go through it all on my own.
I saw Mary Boyle. I knew she was a human being.
I'd say within the hour, Mary was gone. Within the hour.
No way anybody would have come in here without us knowing. There was no stranger in here.
I believe that Mary had a secret. And because Mary was feisty, Mary would have told. So I believe that Mary had to be killed to stop her from telling.
I found that there was a very, very, very defiant, icy air about.
I knew in my heart and soul that I was speaking to the man that was responsible for the missing child.
No way could a child get lost. No way.
The result of that phone call, that certain people weren't allowed to be interviewed, and that it was all hands off them, and we looked somewhere else, as the man says.
Of course it's been covered up. And the main suspect has been guarded by the justice system and higher up.
It's as simple as this. The Mary Boyle case isn't just any case. It's Ireland's longest missing child. The Mary Boyle case is a legacy in many ways. A legacy doesn't just mean a part of history. It means a part of history that has current day meaning. The Mary Boyle case is very much in the minds of everybody in the local area and in the wider Irish public, and in particular to our client.
There was one occasion where they landed on my doorstep without any notice, and I felt intimidated that day.
I knew that I was being framed.
I would say that there are a small cohort of people out there known to Mary who have vital information.
The facts of this case, or any way to describe them, will be simply stomach churning.
Nobody cares about our longest missing person, who is that child, Mary Boyle. None of them care. They don't care about justice. And I'm so sad to say that.
For almost 40 years, Ireland has been haunted by the disappearance of a little girl who vanished on her grandparents' farm here in Cashelard, County Donegal.
Mary Boyle was just 6 years old when she disappeared without trace after going for a walk across fields with her uncle, Jerry Gallagher.
She is Ireland's youngest and longest missing person.
And yet she has almost been written out of Irish history. Mary Boyle is Ireland's Madeleine McCann. The case of the British three-year-old who went missing in Portugal in 2007 has rarely left the headlines. But the story of Mary Boyle has been shrouded in secrecy. On St. Patrick's Day in 1977, Mary Boyle and her family set off on the two-hour journey to her grandparents' remote farm, 5 miles outside Ballyshannon in County Donegal. Early that morning, the family left their home on the west coast near Kincasla and travelled east for the rural townland of Cashelard, where the parents and brother of Mary's mother, Anne Boyle, lived. Mary and her twin sister, Anne, along with their brother Patrick and parents Anne and Charlie Boyle, were going to the anniversary mass of a deceased relative in the parish where Anne Boyle grew up. The following day was a Friday and the family had just finished lunch when Mary vanished within feet of the cottage. She was never seen again. Her uncle Jerry Gallagher said she had followed him across nearby fields when he was returning a ladder to a neighbour. He is the last person known to have seen her alive.
And she quit speaking and looked round and she was heading back in the other direction.
Through the years, her mother, Anne Boyle, and some officers have promoted the theory that Mary was abducted by a stranger.
But this is disputed by Mary's identical twin, Anne Doherty, and some of the retired police officers who were the first on the scene. It is their belief that Mary was murdered by somebody who knew her. In the days after Mary's disappearance, they began to focus on a person of interest who was showing signs of anxiety and distress. But there was a sudden and shocking intervention in the investigation. Some of the officers who were among the first on the scene allege that in the days after Mary's disappearance, a politician contacted Ballyshannon Garda Station and ordered that the chief suspect not be arrested. This politician knew the suspect. He also had a close relationship with Superintendent Dom Murray, who was in charge of the case. New evidence will be revealed for the first time about inconsistencies in accounts of what happened before Mary vanished and in the aftermath of her disappearance. Some of these contradictory accounts were made by Superintendent Dom Murray. The Irish police and Garda Síochána have failed to explain these inconsistencies, leading to claims of cover-up and corruption, and allegations that a child killer has been protected for almost 40 years. Anne and Mary Boyle were identical twins. They were born in Birmingham in 1970. Their parents had met there some years earlier. The couple had emigrated from Donegal, Anne from the rural townland of Cashelard, and Charlie from the tiny island of Oi. Charlie worked in a factory. Anne was a bus conductor. They married in 1967, and their son Patrick was born soon afterwards. 2 years later, Mary and Anne arrived within minutes of each other. In 1972, the family moved back to Donegal, first settling on Oi Island before returning to the mainland. The twins were rarely apart and the bond between them was tight.
Well, Mary was bubbly and she was feisty. She would do the talking for the two of us. No one would walk on her. She would stand up to anyone. She was, very bubbly and... We used to go everywhere together, like we'd maybe two rows in our life. One row we had in school, and the headmaster tied our ponytails together, which he thought would be a terrible punishment, but all we were doing was laughing about it. To be a twin is like to have someone the same as yourself, someone identical to you doing everything that you're doing. You don't want to do anything on your own, you want to go and do it together and spend all your time together and play together and do everything together.
Back home to Donegal, you're the pride of them all. Your people are so kind and so true. And no matter where I roam, I am always going home. Donegal, I'm coming home to you.
Margot O'Donnell is one of Ireland's most successful country singers and a distant cousin of the twins.
My mom was an island lady, and I would have spent a lot of time on the island. In fact, I went to school there for a period of time. I was staying in with my grandparents. And Charlie Boyle, that's Anne and Mary Boyle's and Paddy's father, he would have been a distant relation of my mother's. Island people are very close people. It's a small community. So that was the connection. I knew every family on the island. And the first time that I saw Anne and Mary, the twins, was after they came from Birmingham. They were born over there. And I remember seeing them in the island, and they were going across a little stream that we called the Burn. It ran down through the island, and I didn't know which was which. I couldn't tell the difference, but I remember one of them crossing it quite swiftly, but the other one was nearly dead on her hands and knees. And they were blonde and they were beautiful. And, you know, I'd seen twins before, but not on the island. So that was my first memory of them. And then, of course, they moved out to the mainland, as we call it, out where I lived with my mom and my family. So they lived in a place called Belcritch, Kincastle, and I came from Kincastle. So the last time that I saw the twins was at a regatta that was held down at our little harbour in Kincastle. And my mom always talked, right up until she passed away, about the last time she saw Anne and Mary. And she'd talk about it in the house, and she always sat inside of the window at the front of the house, and she would tell people that would come in, maybe if there was a story going on about Mary at the time. The last time I saw Mary Boyle and Anne, they were walking on that wall coming up from the regatta. So, I think maybe the fact that I actually knew them, you know, I saw Mary Boyle. I knew she was a human being.
The day before she went missing, Mary travelled with her family to the home of her grandparents, the Gallaghers. They rarely went to visit, but a mass was being held for the anniversary of an uncle who was killed in a tractor accident some years earlier.
The day before we went to my grandparents' house, he was sick, and there was a doubt as to whether we'd be able to go for my uncle's anniversary or not. But then I got well enough to go, and I suppose we got ready that morning and headed up to Cashelard. We went to Mass, for it was my uncle's anniversary. And afterwards we would have went to my grandparents' house. I suppose we would have had dinner and went to the fair in Baleek and came back home, and we stayed the night with the grandparents.
On the day she went missing, Mary was wearing a lilac jumper and brown trousers. She had a white and purple ribbon in her hair and was wearing Wellington boots that were a size too big for her. The tiny cottage was cramped. 11 people had stayed there the night before: the twins, Mary and Anne, their brother Patrick, their parents, Anne and Charlie Boyle, Anne Boyle's parents, Lizzie and Patrick, her brother, Jerry Gallagher, his wife, Eva, and their two small children, Gerard and Gregory. After dinner, Anne called her sister out to play, but Mary did not go.
We were playing around and we went and had the dinner, and after dinner I went out to play with my brother and two cousins, and I asked Mary, was she coming outside, and she said no, she was staying in to help with the dishes.
It was the last time Anne would see her identical twin sister alive. To this day, not a fibre from Mary's clothing has been found. Her uncle, Jerry Gallagher, claimed that she had followed him across fields to a neighbour's house, Macaulay's, where he was returning a ladder he said he had borrowed earlier that day. He said he had decided to fix a tile on the roof that had been causing a leak. A member of the local Fianna Fáil party, Mr. Gallagher worked as a charge hand with the Office of Public Works, maintaining local rivers. His neighbour, the Macaulays, lived about 800 metres away, along a path through fields marked with stone walls. Jerry said that Mary climbed over the walls on her own and that he did not help her. According to Mr. Gallagher, they came upon a muddy patch and Mary decided to turn back. He said he continued on and was back at the Gallagher house about a half an hour later. It was around this time that Mary's mother, Anne Boyle, discovered her daughter was missing.
The wee lass, she was following behind, and she come as far as the water. The lane was flooded at the time. And she quit speaking and looked round, and she was heading back in the other direction. And that was the last sight of her ever was seen.
Martin Collins was sergeant in Ballyshannon at the time and one of the first senior officers on the scene in Cashelard after Mary went missing.
When I arrived, I went to the front of Gallagher's house and I was speaking to an uncle of the missing child who briefly set out what happened during the evening, the times that she went missing, etc., etc. And at that particular time, he said that the parents were too upset in the household and not to go in just for the time being.
A number of unusual aspects emerge in witness accounts given to Gardaí in the days after Mary's disappearance. Anne Boyle said she realised her daughter had gone missing at about 4:20 p.m. She said she ran out to the door and shouted to the other children if they had seen Mary. But Jerry Gallagher, who was at a wall in front of the house, stayed silent and did not mention that Mary had followed him. She said he got up and went in the direction of the Macaulay's house. In her statement to Gardaí in March 1977, Anne Boyle labours this point, mentioning it twice. When I looked out and saw only the four children, Jerry was there at the wall. Jerry didn't mention to me at any time that Mary was missing and didn't tell me she was with him until he had the first search carried out.
When she came out of the house originally screaming as to where Mary was, Jerry was fixing or putting some stones on the wall that surrounded the little garden there that's now covered with shrubbery. And at that stage, he never said that the child was with him. It was only when he had a return journey in the direction of Macaulay's and came back, it was then that he said the child was with him.
Sergeant Collins was also concerned about the length of time it took before the Gardaí were alerted about Mary's disappearance. Anne Boyle said her daughter went missing just after 4 p.m. but the Gardaí were not contacted until about 6:30. Mrs. Boyle went on foot to Loch Column Kill, a lake near the cottage, where she spoke to a pair of anglers and asked if they had seen a little girl. They said they hadn't and that she should alert the police. She saw her brother Jerry on the other side of the bank and called over to him to contact the Gardaí. He told her to do it. In the end, it was the fisherman who informed the police.
So there was a 2 hour lapse, or 2 1/4 hour lapse, before it was reported to the Gardaí in Ballyshannon. The time factor in a case like this, 1 minute. 1 minute. Never mind 2.5 hours. 1 minute is important.
Another unusual aspect has emerged in witness statements from the time. Jerry Gallagher said he took Charlie's car, a red Ford Cortina, around the lake to look for Mary and drove it back to the cottage. But Anne Boyle says Jerry left the car on the roadside and that she was the one who drove it away from the lake, calling into a neighbour's house to inquire about Mary. There were other aspects of Jerry Gallagher's story that concerned Sergeant Collins.
For a six-year-old to negotiate these walls and given her size, do you think that is possible, that she climbed these walls?
Listen, I have youngsters the same age, or had them the same age as 6 years old, and certainly I couldn't see them negotiating walls 3 and 4 foot high. And they are a particular wall in that they're single stone walls, and the top stone, as you can see, is just little touch and it can fall either ways. So I couldn't see the child negotiating three of them, one after the other. And Jerry emphasised that at no stage that he would have helped her over the walls. But no.
When news of Mary's disappearance came through, Margot O'Donnell was performing in London.
I was in England for Patrick's Day, touring with my band. And I remember a fella from Ballyshannon coming in and telling me that there was a little girl missing in Cashelard. So anyway, we got talking, and I made a phone call home, and I found out that it was Mary Boyle. And I was upset, you know. I said, I remember his name was Paddy, and I said, Paddy, God, I hope they find her, you know. I'm kind of far out related to her father. So I came home the next day, and I went to Donegal, and my mother was really, really upset about it, and she was talking about Charlie, and, you know, that she would love to go and see him and to see how he was. Island folk were like that. So I said, well, you know, if you want to go tomorrow, I'll drive up. So it was a couple of days after Mary went missing. There was a lot of people about, a lot of cars, because people were heading in the direction of the Gallagher homestead. I had never been there before, so I didn't have a clue where it was. And we went out searching with all the other searchers. I went in the direction of where people said Mary was last seen. It all seemed a bit eerie. There was no two stories, you know, the same.
Through the years, the police authorities, certain crime reporters and Ireland State broadcaster RTE have promoted the theory that Mary was abducted by a stranger. A number of names have been put into the frame, including the sex offender Robert Black and a Sligo man, Brian McMahon, who was arrested in relation to the kidnapping in 2014, but released without charge. At one stage, even members of the travelling community were blamed for Mary's disappearance. During the last 40 years, Anne Boyle too has put forward many different theories as to what happened to her daughter.
Well, first we thought that she just went astray in the mountain, got lost on her way back home. But now we're under the impression that maybe somebody did pick her up.
In an interview for RTE in the year 2000, she and her brother Michael suggested that the six-year-old had left the family of her own accord and gone walking to the town of Baleek in Fermanagh, which was 7 kilometres away across the border in Northern Ireland. They claimed that she had seen toys there that she had liked the previous day.
She was out in Baleek the day before on Patrick's Day. And there was a market in Baleek that day. And yeah. She seen things that she wanted. Didn't she see some toy or something?
Yeah.
No, it's possible. What do you think, Anne?
It's quite possible. It's quite possible that she did. Personally,
myself. Thank God with the search that it got.
Personally, myself, I always thought Mary made her way to that road.
But some senior former officers say there has never been any evidence to support claims that Mary left of her own volition or was taken by a stranger. Detective Sergeant Aidan Murray was in charge of the Garda Special Branch in the area. Mary Boyle's disappearance occurred in an era of high security in Donegal due to the conflict in Northern Ireland, which was raging at the time.
We have three northern counties, Derry, Tyrone and Fermanagh, and there was an awful lot of active IRA units operating from Buntranna right down to Pendoran. My area was very active now at that time.
Well, at that particular time, border security was extremely heavy along the border. We had permanent checkpoints on all traversable cross-border routes. It couldn't be any more heavily policed. During our investigations, vehicles were seen travelling on that road, that by road leading to, which takes you to Baleek or takes you to the Ballantrae. And I know it's only a minor road. At that particular time, there weren't too many cars in this area. As you can see, there are very few houses in this area. The nearest house is Macaulay's, which is a quarter of a mile away. The next nearest place is the old school down there, which is a mile away. You know, there are no houses. So the vehicles that were seen on that road at that particular, covering that particular period, they were checked out and eliminated from our inquiries.
There was a minibus of people came from down our, the Rosses, that's where we came from, the area, and they went up to search. And I remember we were in the village of Kincastle waiting for the bus to come back, and we asked any news when they returned, and we had like soup and sandwiches for them because they'd been away all day. And some of them said, oh, we're not going up there anymore. It's easy seeing what happened. They all know what happened, that wee girl.
In the days after Mary Boyle's disappearance, Sergeant Martin Collins was leaving the Garda station here in Ballyshannon when he was approached by a man who knew Mary Boyle.
A person who would have been known to Mary made it his business to contact me at Ballyshannon Garda station. This would be some, maybe a week after Mary going missing. And he requested to meet me. But at the particular time, I was engaged in meeting my colleagues from Bundoran. From Ballyshannon to Bundoran is only 4 miles. So I told this person that I was meeting my colleagues from Bundoran. I'd be only a few minutes, and to remain at the station until I came back. In the meantime, I went to Bundoran, and halfway to Bundoran, which only took about 3 minutes, this person drove his own car behind our patrol car and pulled in behind us at Finner, which only halfway between Ballyshannon and Bundoran. When I finished with the Bundoran lads, I got out of the patrol car and sat into his motor car. And when I did, he began to cry and sobbing, and told me that what a terrible thing had happened, that he knew those little girls, the twins, and that he was very fond of them, loved them, and that he had children of the same age, and how he felt about Mary's disappearance. So in the course of the conversation, I put 3 scenarios to him. One was that she's still missing out there. Second was that she was kidnapped. And the third one, bluntly, murder. And I says, which of those 3 scenarios would you think were responsible for Mary's disappearance? And he said, the last one. So I said, you mean murder? And he said, yes.
The person who made these allegations to Sergeant Collins was a relation of the suspect. In the days after Mary's disappearance, Detective Sergeant Aidan Murray spoke to this suspect.
Inspector Daly, who recently was deceased, and myself interviewed that man. We interviewed him at one stage. I was interviewing him, and I told him, I said, just tell us where the child is. At that stage then, he started crying and roaring and accusing me that I was accusing of the murder of the child. I got a little nudge from the inspector at the time under the table to ease off a wee bit. So I was reluctant a wee bit, but I did ease off because it was more or less an instruction. And I went out and got him a glass of water and the instructions of the inspector. When I came back then, the particular man had gone back to himself again. I felt that my own heart, that he had a guilty look. I could see it in his eyes, and it was just that wee extra wee push, and he would admit it. When you do interview a person, especially a very strong suspect, you can, after a number of years, you can see things in their eyes if they're really telling you the truth, or they look away from you. And I knew from previous experience that if you have a man at a certain level, you don't pull back, you just push that a wee bit extra. And I felt that I had him. It was a defence, that he was defending himself, that what he'd done was wrong. But I thought if I'd had somebody else with me, maybe that extra wee bit of pressure would have, we wouldn't have been here today now talking.
It was during this time frame that a phone call came through to the Garda station here in Ballyshannon.
I was in the station along with several others. We had a station party of 70 or 80 members at that particular time because of the heavy security. And at any one time, you could find 9 or 10 members in and around the station, clerical workers, etc., etc. And a phone call was made to Ballyshannon Station. It was a politician. The gist of the conversation was that none of a particular family should be made suspect for Mary's disappearance.
Well, I know that that the result of that phone call, that certain people weren't allowed to be interviewed, and that it was all hands off them, and we would look somewhere else, as the man says. As it was said, that the sting of the whole investigation went out of the whole investigation, you know.
In April 2016, these allegations were put on the record of the European Parliament by Dublin MEP Lynn Boylan.
This is Mary Boyle, Ireland's longest missing child case. Six-year-old Mary disappeared in 1977, and the man whom her twin sister believes is responsible for her disappearance still lives in that community and has never been formally brought in for questioning. Allegedly, a still-sitting politician directly intervened, and that intervention led to one of the worst cases of police cover-up we have seen in Ireland. Almost 1 year ago, I brought Mary's twin sister Anne to this Parliament seeking justice. Article 2 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights guarantees the right to life. Six-year-old Mary was denied that right. Article 20 of the Charter guarantees the right to equality before the law. Mary was denied that right. To this day, there has been no inquest into Mary's death, no commission of investigation, despite a formal request from the legal team. In fact, it has never even been debated in the Irish Parliament, which is why I am forced to raise it here tonight. Six-year-old Mary Boyle has been failed by the Irish state.
Even after these disturbing allegations were made in Brussels, they were all but ignored in the Irish Parliament and mainstream media. The deafening silence about the case in Ireland even prompted one British newspaper, The Guardian, to ask, why has Ireland's mainstream media turned its back on Mary Boyle?
I do believe that there was a senior officer who sort of had to play ball with this politician. Was it blackmail? I don't know. I've heard an awful lot of things that make my skin crawl and makes me realise that we have absolutely no justice system in this country.
Don Murray was the local superintendent in Ballyshannon at the time of Mary Boyle's disappearance. He died in 2014. Through the years, he gave a number of conflicting accounts about the Mary Boyle case. In an interview broadcast on RTE in 2000, he stated that Jerry had told Mary to go home during their walk through the fields. However, this contradicts Jerry's account of what happened. In his statement, he said he did not tell Mary to go back to the cottage and that she left of her own accord. Superintendent Murray also said that Jerry and Mary came upon a pool of water which was 2 feet deep. In fact, this pool was no more than 6 inches in depth.
He wanted her to go home because it was a cold, miserable evening, and she stopped for a while and he went on, but then he looked again and she was still following him. And as he came in then up to a lane which leads from a Corley's, he turned into the lane and went down through. And he came to a lock of water which was about 2 foot in depth. And he walked easily through it in his Wellingtons with the ladder. And when he got to the other side, he looked back and he saw Mary. Anyway, but when he looked back, he saw Mary at the edge of the water on the other side. And he said to her, go on home. Didn't I tell you to go home, or words to that effect? And Mary said, she says, I can't get across. And he said, you go on home. So he continued on. That was the last time he saw Mary.
In 1985, an RTE documentary made allegations of wrongdoing against Superintendent Murray. It revealed that a 17-page letter of complaint had been written about him to Garda Management by another officer now deceased. The officer described untouchables untouched by the law and alleged an Old Pals Act was operating in the Ballyshannon district. The complaint contained extraordinary allegations against some officers and voiced serious concerns felt by some rank-and-file Gardaí. It found frustration and anger among ordinary officers about how Garda headquarters handled complaints. It also outlined the close relationship Superintendent Murray had with some members of Fianna Fáil and alleged that in 1979, Superintendent Murray had even attended a Fianna Fáil convention in Castlebar, County Mayo. Under Garda regulations, officers are prohibited from identifying themselves actively or publicly with political parties. In the early 1990s, about 15 years after Mary disappeared, Sergeant Martin Collins was approaching retirement. He was keen to speak to the suspect before he left the force for good. A psychic with an interest in the case had come to the area. She had gone to the Gallagher cottage in Cashelard, but had left in a state of distress. She asked to see the suspect in the local Garda station. Sergeant Collins used it as an opportunity to speak to him again.
Took him into an office and told him that he wasn't arrested, that he was free to go at any time he wished, but I had like to put certain questions to him, which I did. Again, over a short period of conversation, I told him that there were three scenarios that I wished to put to him. One of them was that the child is still missing out there, that she was kidnapped or taken away, and the third one was that she was murdered out there. And I told him that my belief was that this person had murdered Mary. I was expecting a verbal or physical reaction to my question. It didn't materialize. Again, began to rehash the whole thing about Mary's disappearance from the time she went missing, from the time she was last seen, and this person said nothing.
Did he deny what happened, what you were putting to him?
No.
He didn't deny it?
No.
What
he didn't admit, nor he didn't deny.
And could you interpret anything as an experienced police officer that if you put it to a witness that they were involved in a crime and they do not deny it, can you read anything into that?
Well, from my experience, I felt that I was almost at a point where I was going to get an admission. But unfortunately, it stalled. The conversation stalled.
The suspect left here that afternoon and to this day has never been arrested.
He was never arrested. He was probably invited into the station as a witness. But then, as I said, I went questioning him for as a witness and more or less into a suspect nature too. But he was never arrested for the crime of Morth and the child.
One of the most disturbing aspects of the case is the claim that a person close to Mary has revealed the identity of the killer on a number of occasions. The Gardaí have been aware of this for a long time, but the person who others believe is withholding vital information has never been arrested. Through the years, you were also told by another person known to Mary the identity of the killer. Can you tell me about that?
Yes, another person who would be known to Mary. I've spoken to that person on a number of occasions, but on at least three occasions, that person told me that she knew who the person was that murdered Mary.
So
That's right. Someone that was known to me and Mary told me that they knew what had happened to Mary and that they knew the identity of the killer.
I was told 77, and I had my own ideas about it. I didn't point a finger, but I had my own thoughts on it, like everybody else had. And somebody very close to Mary in 1980 told me that they knew what happened to Mary and they knew who murdered her. In 1994, that same person told me again, and there was a little bit more added on to it.
There's definitely somebody that knows it very close to that person, very, very close, know rightly what they're holding and know rightly if they came forward that this matter would be cleared up and the child would be led the lesson, would have an end to the whole matter, this brutal mother, you know. These persons are as guilty as him by holding back and knowing that they're guilty. I don't know why how they can look at themselves.
And I remember I was asked by that person, and it stuck me to the chair I sat on. You will never forget about Mary, will you? And I said, no. Why was the next question. And I was flabbergasted.
Those who have never given up on justice for Mary have little doubt about the motive for her murder.
I believe that Mary had a secret. And because Mary was feisty, Mary would have told. So I believe that Mary had to be killed to stop her from telling.
What do you think the secret was?
I said Mary was sexually assaulted. Would it be the secret?
Mary was chatty, and I believe Mary was sexually molested, and she probably said, I'll tell. And for that reason, our little Mary Boyle had to die.
Is it your belief that Mary was sexually assaulted before her death?
Over the years, yes. Looking back on it over the years, I'd say yes.
It's hateful to see a person you know that has committed such an atrocious crime, especially with a child. That was always my thing. Any person that interfered with a child. I had two things in my life when I was in the police force. Anybody interfering with a child or an old person where they couldn't defend themselves.
For many years, the retired detectives have feared that the chief suspect remains a danger. But despite reporting their concerns to their authorities, he is still at large. Margot O'Donnell and Anne Doherty have also pleaded with the Gardaí to act.
If it was a thing that this suspect did what I think he did to Mary, certainly he would be a danger to other persons.
This is your belief that before he killed Mary, that he sexually assaulted her?
That's my belief, yes.
During the years, have you expressed those concerns to An Garda Síochána?
Yes. My concern certainly was brought to the notice of my authorities, and I'm sure other members as well had the same concerns and brought it to the notice of authorities.
When I was a young girl, I respected the collar and the uniform. But that's gone as far as the uniform is concerned for me, because I was talking to deaf ears. They did nothing to help solve the Mary Boyle case.
Margot O'Donnell has never given up hope that Mary Boyle's body will be found. Single-handedly, she has commissioned searches and devoted a huge amount of time and effort in her fight for justice for the little girl. In 2011, she decided to start yet another search and reached out to Anne Doherty again.
I decided, yes, I'm going to give the Mary Boyle case another search. I had contacted Anne Doherty, who was never really included in any of the searches. You know, she was irrelevant. And I phoned her and I realised, you know, she really was in an awful place about her sister. And I said, do you want to come help me try to find Mary? And she said, of course I do. I says, how much do you want Mary found? And she says, I want it more than anything else in the world. And I says, can you be here? This was Monday. Can you be here on Wednesday in Cashelard? And she says, I can.
Margot O'Donnell contacted Ballyshannon Station to ask them for ordnance survey maps of the Cashelard area to assist her with her search.
And I asked the guards to get the maps. The guard, the liaison officer in Ballyshannon said to me, no problem, I'll get them. And I never heard from her, and I kept phoning and phoning and phoning. And one particular day, I remember I phoned, and this male voice answered the phone, and I said, could I speak to the person I wanted to speak to? And he said, she's not here, haven't seen her about today. I said, are you a guard? And he says, oh, I am, yeah. And I says, well, maybe you can help me. I asked for maps. I says, it's to do with the Mary Boyle case. And he says, the what? The Mary Boyle case. He says, that case is all over. He says, there's nothing here. That's too long ago. I says, are you for real? And he says, oh, that's far too long ago. He says, that case is over and done, what?
In 2014, the case took another sinister twist when two officers arrived at the home of Anne Doherty without prior notice.
There was one occasion where they landed on my doorstep without any notice, and I felt intimidated that day. The two guards landed. I live up in Offaly in the middle of nowhere. Two guards landed and knocked on the door and just said they were in the area and asked could they speak, and I just felt intimidated that day.
And where had they come from?
From Donegal. Well, one had travelled from Donegal, I think maybe the other one, Monaghan, actually.
What did they tell you? Why did they come to you?
They tried to put into my head that the chief suspect wasn't the chief suspect and to make another man the suspect.
This person was Brian McMahon, a 63-year-old man from the neighbouring county of Sligo. When he was arrested in relation to the kidnapping of Mary Boyle in October 2014, those seeking justice and many who knew Mr. McMahon were deeply disturbed. A popular man in his local community, whom many believed had been done an earlier injustice by the state, they were adamant he had nothing to do with it.
37 years after 6-year-old Mary Boyle went missing, Gardaí today made the first arrest in this long-running investigation. A 64-year-old man was taken from the Midlands prison at midday on a Section 42 warrant which allows Gardaí detain inmates.
The new lines of evidence have emerged which have led us to where we are here today, in that a man in his 60s was arrested this morning in relation to the kidnapping of Mary Boyle in Donegal in 1977. That person is currently detained here at Mullingar Garda Station and is currently being questioned in relation to that matter.
Well, I knew instinctively that something untoward was going on.
Around the time Margot O'Donnell and Anne Doherty were becoming vocal again, Brian McMahon was arrested about the case. When Mary disappeared in 1977, he was a young soldier in Finnair Army Camp outside Ballyshannon. Abandoned by his mother as a child, he had grown up in state institutions and in a foster home in Cashelard, where he was subjected to severe physical abuse. His foster mother had been deemed unsuitable to look after children. As an adult, he received compensation from the State Redress Board. In 2013, Brian McMahon was convicted of indecent assault after allegations were made against him of offences dating back to when he was a teenager. He says he is innocent of the charges. At the time of his arrest for the Mary Boyle case, he was serving a sentence in the Midlands prison in Portlaoise.
They wanted to interview me in relation to the disappearance of Mary Boyle. They were waving the warrants over everybody else's head. I was in a state of shock. I wasn't able really to talk at all. I just turned around and I said to the officer, the officer in charge, I said, "Not at all," I said, "officer." I says, "I never had anything to do with that child's disappearance."
When Mary went missing, Brian McMahon was a soldier at Fenner Army Camp outside Ballyshannon, about 12 kilometres from where she disappeared. He believes he was on the camp the day she vanished. He did not know Mary Boyle and had no car, but it was put to him that he walked to the Gallagher's remote farm, managed to abduct the six-year-old from her family and take her away on foot.
They brought me to Mullingar, Garda station, and I was almost certain that I wasn't going to make it, you know, that I was going to in the verge of a complete breakdown. They would place the siren on top of the car, and they were going at an enormous rate. I felt that was a little bit intimidating. They just suggested that I arrived at this on this particular road, and lo and behold, they said, there was your prize catch on the road. I thought it was a despicable statement to come out with, you know. The following night, I was placed into a car, an unmarked police car, and I believe that was for the purpose of a member of the press to get a picture. They were determined to get a confession from me. They were, of course. But I knew that those two guys themselves knew 100% that I wasn't the man they should be looking for.
In 2015, the DPP decided that charges would not be brought against Brian McMahon in relation to the Mary Boyle case. He is now considering a legal action against the Gardaí and the state for unlawful arrest. Former Sergeant Martin Collins was one of the many people in Donegal and Sligo alarmed by the arrest of Brian McMahon.
Well, the first I heard of it was when I saw it on RTE, and I didn't know the particular person. As I said, 39 years ago since Mary went missing, I didn't know the particular person, but certainly that name never came up in our original investigation.
Do you believe it is possible that he had anything to do with Mary's murder?
Impossible.
Another name that has been put into the frame by some Gardaí and certain crime reporters is the Scottish sex offender Robert Black. In his book Missing, RTE crime reporter Barry Cummins devotes several pages to suggestions that Robert Black may have been linked to Mary's disappearance. He writes, if a local suspect could not be found, the other possibility, and one that remains to this day, is that a person from outside the locality, possibly a foreigner, abducted Mary Boyle. He says Robert Black was certainly a suspect in the case of Mary Boyle, and it is the informed opinion of the Gardaí and police in the north that Robert Black was in Ireland in early 1977 and was most probably in the north the day Mary Boyle disappeared 4 or 5 miles from the border. In 2008, a Belfast-based company called Sterling Productions was commissioned by RTE to make a programme about Mary Boyle. It was called Cracking Crime, and Barry Cummins was the key contributor. One of the key theories in the programme, again, was that Mary was abducted by a stranger. The programme was made with the assistance of An Garda Síochána. When Robert Black died in January 2016, Barry Cummins again linked him to the Mary Boyle case, but failed to mention all of the new key developments, including the fact that those closest to Mary Boyle and seeking justice for her believed that Black had nothing to do with her murder.
At 7 o'clock on Wednesday the 13th of January on RT Radio 1. This is Morning Ireland with Gavin Jennings and Cathal McCullough.
The possible County Donegal connection relates to the disappearance of another child, Mary Boyle, 4 years earlier, 1977. First of all, tell us what's known insofar as the details are clear about her disappearance.
Robert Black's name has been linked with Mary Boyle for many, many years. Nothing tangible to show he was in County Donegal at that time, but certainly it would have fitted his modus operandi.
Now, through the years, other scenarios have been put forward as to what may have happened to Mary Boyle, and among them a number of names have been linked with her disappearance, including the sex offender Robert Black. Do you believe it is conceivable that he had anything to do with her murder?
No.
Why do you believe that?
Why I believe that, there's no evidence whatsoever that he was in the Ballyshannon area or he was in the Cashelard area. And it would be a chance in millions for him to appear in Cashelard at the particular time that Mary went missing, which was a span of about 40 minutes in an isolated, and I mean isolated, part of countryside. No houses within 400 or 500 yards, except one. And to be in the particular area where Mary was last seen, an impossibility.
When you hear his name being linked to her murder by certain journalists, how does it make you feel?
I cringe when I hear it, because I know that it's so remote for he to be in that particular area at that particular time, at that particular minute, so remote.
Is it possible that Mary Boyle fell into a slurry pit?
No.
A swamp?
No.
A lake?
No.
Any other water source?
No. Because all those lakes were checked by the Subaco crowd, even Columkill Lock. There was a blind lock near Columkill Lock. It came under notice at a very early stage, and it was completely cleaned out, but no, nothing.
In 2015, Margot and Anne renewed their efforts for justice. Through the years, Gardaí had told them they would only deal with Anne Boyle, Mary's mother, because she was Mary's next of kin. Margot and Anne decided to try to take the case away from Ballyshannon Garda Station and to one of the biggest stations in the country, Pierce Street, in the heart of the capital city, Dublin.
I had gone to all the guards I could. I had searched what diggers and men. I had done all I possibly could. I was exhausted. And I thought, Pierce Street, yeah, let's do it. So Anne and I went in and we told our story.
I went to Pierce Street with Margot O'Donnell to make a statement, which I thought, if you go to Pierce Street, they're bound to arrest the chief suspect. But as of yet, no arrest. And from what I can see, nothing's been done.
Nothing came out of Pierce Street. No more than Ballyshannon. I was spoken to with Anne. I was brought upstairs. And he told me that he was a big fan of Margot's, the voice of an angel. And he promised me that this statement and Anne's wouldn't fall on deaf ears, nor would it be stuck into a drawer and put away. You know what? I think it was put further in the drawer. So what did we get from Pierce Street? Nothing. I know there's a lot of people would want me to go away. I haven't gone away, so I do feel in a dangerous position.
Until recently, Mary Boyle's name had all but faded into history. The case of Ireland's youngest missing person was an inconvenient mystery that seemed destined to remain unresolved. In 2005, the twins' father, Charlie, died in a mysterious fishing accident. He had never recovered from the loss of his daughter. Anne Doherty believes he knew what happened to her, but was unable to act. In recent times, with the support of Margot O'Donnell, Anne decided to take her sister's case to an international audience in the hope that she would be listened to abroad. She joined a group of bereaved Irish families on a visit to the Northern Ireland Parliament in Stormont to speak to politicians there about the case. The families were also alleging Garda corruption in their loved ones' investigations and that they too had been denied justice by the state. It was the first in a series of trips Anne would make to highlight the case, which also took her to Brussels, Westminster and Washington. When Enda Kenny became Taoiseach in 2011, Margot O'Donnell, conscious of his strong Donegal connections, decided to contact him. Mr. Kenny's mother, Ethna, came from the town of Glencolumbkill in South Donegal, and he maintained close ties to the area.
Now, I knew Enda Kenny when I would work in Castlebar and the Traveller's Friend. I knew him through the promoter there. But I didn't know him as a politician. And I thought, he's just been elected, you know, Taoiseach, and to heck, I'll phone him. So I phoned him on his mobile. I got his mobile and I phoned him and he answered. And I said to him, Enda, I am ringing you about the Mary Boyle case. And I said, I think you could help me, you know, find out what happened and maybe find her body. And he said I would have to go to the Minister of Justice. I says, I don't want to go to the Minister of Justice. I'm asking you to help me. He was, at that time, leading our country. He was the head man. And he did nothing.
In October 2015, Enda Kenny was asked about the case in Dáil Éireann. He admitted that he had been given information about it, which he had passed back to the Gardaí, but did not know if it had been followed up.
Anne, the twin sister of Mary Boyle, a six-year-old girl who disappeared close to her grandparents' home in Donegal in 1977. Anne firmly believes that there was both political interference and a Garda cover-up in Mary's case. Taoiseach, would you be willing to meet with Mary's sister, Anne, to listen to her concerns regarding the Garda handling of the case?
I'm aware of the case of Mary Boyle. It's many years ago now. I've had some contact about this quite a number of years ago, which I brought to the attention of the Gardaí, and I can't say whether the allegation made was followed up or not. But I brought it to the attention of the Gardaí. It's a number of years ago, Deputy.
Almost 40 years on, Anne Doherty and Margot O'Donnell are still searching for the remains of Ireland's youngest missing child. They are certain Mary's body was dumped close to where she went missing.
In December 2015, Anne Doherty's legal team
requested that a new search for Mary Boyle's remains be carried out in the Cashelard area. That request has been denied.
A mother of five, Anne Doherty has left Donegal and lives in the Midlands today with her husband Shane. She is estranged from her mother, whom she says has tried to obstruct her in her campaign for justice. Anne Boyle recently sent her daughter and Margot O'Donnell solicitors' letters threatening legal action against them. In a recent radio interview, she ridiculed her daughter's justice campaign live on air.
You know, things can be done quietly, not publicly, and running to Dáil's and running to Westminster and all this carry on. That's the most ridiculous carry on I ever seen in my life.
Mary's twin sister Anne Doherty has renewed efforts to have an inquest into her sister's death. In December 2015, she met the Donegal coroner, Dr. Dennis McCauley, and urged him to convene an inquest in an effort to find out the truth about how her sister died. Her mother, Anne Boyle, however, has said that she does not want an inquest and will state in her will that she does not want one after she is deceased. This lies in stark contrast to the many claims Anne Boyle has made through the years in the media, stating that she hoped she would find out what happened to her daughter before she died.
We had so many disappointments over the years where our hopes was raised and we thought that we would find her within days, but it has never come to pass. But you always like to see an end to the situation that we're in. It'd be nice to see an end.
If they have anything at all to come up, to come forward with it, because the Garda will treat it with the best of confidence, and hopefully that there will be an end to Mary's case.
So looking back on the 18 years when your mind must have been consumed with it, probably every one of those days, what do you now suspect or think may have happened to Mary?
That's a very hard question again.
But would you believe Mary to be dead now, do you?
I think so, because I think she would have come, that we would have some kind of information by now.
If Mary is dead, that we could find a body and that we could bury her. And then we might have peace of mind. Pray every day that I will find out what happened to Mary.
Anne Doherty believes that an inquest is the appropriate mechanism to find out what happened to Mary. But the coroner, Dennis McCauley, has resisted attempts by her legal team to convene it. According to Anne's lawyer, Dara Macken, Dr. McCauley has now informed him that he is not in favour of an inquest because it will have an adverse effect on Anne Boyle's health. Anne Doherty feels she has been left with no choice but to sue the Irish police and government for failing to bring Mary's killer to justice. She is preparing a legal action to the European Court of Human Rights for breaching her right to justice for her sister.
Article 2 of the European Convention on Human Rights is the right to life. It's not just the right to life, but it enshrines a detachable obligation, which is the right to an effective investigation in certain circumstances. And certain circumstances can arise in a number of different ways, one of which is whether or not there's been state involvement or state effectively failure to investigate, or more than that, whether or not it's been a suspicious death. The reality is, like as I've already outlined, Mary Boyle's disappearance and death clearly ticks all of them boxes, and Article 2 is clearly engaged in these circumstances. We've already made representations to the Minister of Justice and the Senior Coroner in respect of that obligation. We would say that that obligation has never been discharged by any of the state bodies at this stage. We would say that the investigation to this point hasn't been effective. Given the threshold for an arrest is obviously that there is a reasonable suspicion, we would say that test has been passed. But in any event, we would say that the appropriate mechanism now for investigating this incident and the wider death and the circumstances of Mary Boyle's disappearance is that of an inquest, because an inquest can, unlike other mechanisms we would say, discharge the obligation enshrined on Article 2 of the European Convention. We have evidence from in the shape of witness statements from both Sergeant Martin Collins and Aidan Murray, who were both involved in the original investigation and who give a clear account of how there was deliberate political intervention in the original investigation. That political intervention came in the shape and form of a phone call to prevent what we would say is the subsequent arrest and prosecution and possible admission of guilt from that individual.
To this day, Gardaí have been unwilling and unable to explain all of the inconsistencies that have emerged about Mary Boyle's disappearance. A series of questions to An Garda Síochána about the case went unanswered.
The retired officers who are so desperate to see justice done for Mary have not been interviewed by An Garda Síochána in recent times.
You made the decision to call for Noreen O'Sullivan's resignation.
That's right. I believe she should resign because she isn't taking the case the way that she's not treating the case properly. It's her duty to get a killer off the streets and to safeguard different children. She's not doing that.
Do you believe that the Gardaí have enough evidence to arrest the killer?
Well, from the evidence that I give, I believe they have more than enough evidence to arrest the killer.
And you also met Enda Kenny in November 2015. How did that go?
Well, he said he would send a letter, he'd get somebody to send a letter, but nothing has come of it. I thought he would maybe put a bit of pressure on the guards, but that doesn't seem to have happened.
So do you feel you have been let down by the authorities?
I feel totally let down by the authorities. And more importantly, as I said, I believe Mary's been let down by them.
After countless attempts to try to get a meeting with the current leader of Fianna Fáil, Anne Doherty and Margot O'Donnell finally met Micheál Martin in April 2016. They told him of their concerns about a Garda cover-up and allegations that a Fianna Fáil politician had interfered in the case and asked him to seek an independent inquiry. He said he could not intervene and would hand the matter to the Gardaí and the Garda Ombudsman, GSOC. More than a year ago, Anne Doherty asked Ireland's Justice Minister, Francis Fitzgerald, for a meeting, but she has declined. However, the minister says she has met with the mother of Mary Boyle and was grateful to do so. She also stated that a review of the case had been ongoing for almost 5 years, since 2011.
I am advised by the Garda authorities that a comprehensive review into this case has in fact been ongoing since 2011 under the direction of the Assistant Commissioner for the Northern Region, and indeed I met with the mother of the missing child in this case at last year's National Missing Persons Day. I was grateful to have been able to speak with her on that occasion and also to hear her moving address to those present as to the lasting impact these events have had on her and on her family.
Indeed, there's allegations that there may have been political interference as well, and to make sure that this person wasn't considered as a suspect, and that is the nature of the statements that they've made in the last couple of weeks.
I would encourage people to give that information, and if they have, I have no doubt that what you have said will happen.
Thanks, Minister. As I understand it, Minister, the Garda authorities are aware of these allegations.
The Gallagher House in Cashelard lies derelict today. It is still owned by Jerry Gallagher, who lives several miles away in Ballintra, but who visits it regularly. Initially, he gave us permission to film on the land where Mary disappeared, but he has subsequently withdrawn that permission. Jerry Gallagher and Mary Boyle's mother, Anne, were invited to take part in this programme, but they both refused.
The twins' brother, Patrick Boyle, works out of the United States today. He was unavailable to participate. For the retired officers who spent their careers longing to find Mary Boyle's remains and to see justice done for her, they remain disillusioned that day will ever come. It was their hope that they would see justice before they retired, Now they can only hope that they will see it before they die.
There are a small number of people out there who would have been known to Mary Boyle, who are withholding vital information.
They even think of interfering with a child. If he did it once, I would never let him know that he could do it again.
There's a lot of people out there that know the truth, and it's time they spoke up. I am very, very annoyed that almost 40 years on, a little girl's bones lie up there in Cashelard, very close to the Gallagher homestead, where nothing could harm her, nothing. It had to be a person. No UFO came down from the sky. Mary was murdered.
I'm not stopping until the day I'm going 6 foot under. I'm not stopping fighting for Mary.
It's extremely important to our client that she has an opportunity to grieve properly for the loss of her sister, until, firstly, that her sister's remains are found, located. Secondly, until her sister is actually deemed deceased. And thirdly, until the individual who she believes is responsible is questioned in respect of that. Only then, when them three stages are completely fulfilled, can our client properly grieve.
Sometimes I can't look at him. I just have to look away from him. But I do look at him. And everyone belonged to him.
You know, my mother was 94 years of age in May of 2014. And she would have been 95 in July. And on her deathbed, she died at 3:48 a.m. in the morning. At 4 o'clock the evening before, she woke up from a slumber, and I was sitting on a chair near the bed. And she looked down at me, and I said, "Are you all right, Ma?" And she said, "Margaret, you won't forget about wee Mary Boyle, will you?"
I've got to know Anne Doherty down the years, and I know the way she feels. She was her twin sister, and I can associate with that because I'm a twin myself, and it would be great if, for her sake, to have it brought to a successful conclusion.
This is obviously a case with significant public interest. It's in everybody's interest, obviously, that Ireland's longest missing child is found. When you look at the facts, I don't think anybody within the Irish public would say that they would not wish Mary Boyle to be found.
I would wish that this child remains would be found, and that the person involved would confess to this and relieve us all, and relieve himself and prepare himself for the next world. I would like to see him doing that, to give it a final closure and a final grave to Anne. That's all my wish would be before I part this world myself.
Well, it's the very least that Mary deserves is justice. It's the very, very least. And like everyone else, she deserves a proper investigation. She deserves a decent burial. It's her human right, and it should be given to her.
People don't do it for me. Let them do it for Anne Doherty. Give her back the other half of her, and I will die happy. Honour the little girl with the golden hair and the beautiful face. That's all I want.